dreams, they feel real while we're in them, right? It's only when we wake up that we realize something was actually strange.
We're dreaming?
I wanted to address Inception as a therapeutic concept.
Inception. Is it possible?
The interplay between the physical reality and the dream reality when he talks about the face full of glass, that also works in reverse, though. What's going on in our real world can affect what's going on in the dream. Sometimes we have dreams and nightmares about things we're unwilling to face in real life.
You said we'd grow out together!
Can you experience real life catharsis through a dream? And can that actually be healing?
Absolutely.
They say we only use a fraction of our brain's true potential. That's when we're awake. When we're asleep, our mind can do almost anything.
So this brings us to the question, does the top fall?
This episode was filmed during the writers and actors strike. Without their labor, our show wouldn't exist. We support their strike efforts. If you'd like to support them as well, go to www.entertainmentcommunity.org and donate.
Hello and welcome to Cinema Therapy. I'm Jonathan Decker, and you mustn't be afraid to dream a little bigger, darling.
And I'm Alan Seawright, and...
I did not know that he could do that. Today we're going to be exploring Inception and the psychology of dreams.
I'm so excited about this for so many reasons!
I had to do some research on this one because this is outside of my wheelhouse, my area of expertise.
I had to, too. I had to watch Inception 4 times. It was great.
It's a small price to pay. First of all, probably Chris Nolan's best movie.
Oh yeah, definitely. I mean, you can make an argument for The Prestige, but this has snowmobiles and guns.
Well, and this is big budget summer escapist movie making that's also a film with a capital F, without being snooty and pretentious about it.
So great.
And when people say Nolan is all head and no heart, I point to Inception, because there's a really strong beating heart here. So we're going to look at, what is the psychology of dreams? Why do we dream? And fact versus fiction on the claims this film makes about how dreams and sleeping work.
Excellent.
And then you can talk about a freaking masterpiece.
So many things.
All right.
Not enough time.
Let's
do
it.
So here we go.
What do you want from us?
Inception. Is it possible?
Of course not.
If you can steal an idea from someone's mind, why can't you plant one there instead?
Okay. Here's me planting an idea in your head. I say to you, don't think about elephants. What are you thinking about?
Elephants.
Right, but it's not your idea because you know I gave it to you. The subject's mind can always trace the genesis of the idea. True inspiration's impossible to fake.
It's not true.
I'm doing it right now.
Can you do it?
Are you offering me a choice? Because I can find my own way to square things with Cole.
Then you do have a choice.
And I choose to leave, sir.
Leonardo DiCaprio is Christopher Nolan, and Ken Watanabe is Warner Brothers.
I wanted to address Inception as a therapeutic concept because it's always more powerful for people to think of things on their own.
Yes.
So when Joseph Gordon-Levitt's talking about, you know, the idea came from an external source, that's why I don't tell people what to do.
Right.
Because if I tell people what to do, they don't have those light bulb moments that they own, that they feel are theirs. Because when they own them, then they also do them and
right.
apply them. And if it comes from somebody else, there's a little voice inside most of us.
You can discount it. Yeah, that's somebody else's idea.
Yeah, they can discount it, or they just want to rebel against it because we don't like to be told what to do.
Sure.
And so it's far more powerful to guide people with questions. It's called motivational interviewing. And if it's done poorly, it's leading questions and manipulation.
Mm-hmm.
And if it's done well, it's done with the intent of, I'm not looking for you to land at a specific place. I'm looking for you to open up what's in here and find insight and wisdom.
And it's the same thing with filmmaking. Again, therapists and filmmakers, we have the same job.
It's to get people to feel things and give us money.
Get people to feel things and give us money.
Joke's on you. I'm into that.
The way we do it in film, like, you can incept someone into having their own idea by showing, not telling. Every time I bang on about show, don't tell, that doesn't necessarily mean you can't show through dialogue. You can show through dialogue. You can also tell with a visual. What's interesting and what's, you know, a higher form of filmmaking is giving people all the clues and then letting them figure it out before either the character does or before you reveal to them. And obviously, one of the most fun forms of filmmaking is giving people all the clues and then revealing it to them, but it was completely different. Thank you, Rian Johnson.
What the sh?
Boy, that escalated quickly.
This episode is sponsored by Surfshark.
Surfshark is a VPN, a virtual private network.
With Surfshark, you can change your virtual location while you are traveling so that you can still connect back to your country and still enjoy all of your favorite sites and shows.
Ooh, does it even work if you're stuck in limbo?
That's not a physical location, so sure.
Sweet, if I was stuck in limbo, I could still access ESPN and watch all of my local sports teams.
Well, Surfshark's clean web automatically blocks more than 1 million known malicious websites and phishing methods.
Just like if someone is trying to maliciously hack into your mind.
Yeah, kind of like that, but more in the real world and your computer, not your subconscious.
My computer is my subconscious.
Surfshark Alert is part of an add-on security combo that monitors your personal data, checks for potential breaches, and gives you real-time breach alerts.
Just like the projections in your subconscious that alert you when someone is trying to breach into your mind?
And it has GPS spoofing on Android.
In case you need to hide your location from COBOL engineering.
Uh-huh. And it can fool apps that track your geographical location.
Get Surfshark VPN at surfshark.deals/cinematherapy and enter promo code
cinematherapy
for an exclusive offer and 3 extra months free, no inception required.
They say we only use a fraction of our brain's true potential. Now, that's when we're awake. When we're asleep, our mind can do almost anything.
Such as?
Well, imagine you're designing a building, right? You consciously create each aspect. But sometimes it feels like it's almost creating itself, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, like I'm discovering it.
Genuine inspiration, right? Mm-hmm. Now, in a dream, our mind continuously does this. We create and perceive our world simultaneously, and our mind does this so well that we don't even know what's happening.
It's very true.
It allows us to get right in the middle of that process.
How?
By taking over the creating part. Now, this is where I need you. You create the world of the dream. We bring the subject into that dream, and they fill it with their subconscious.
This is a movie about making movies.
Require enough detail to make them think that it's reality.
Well, dreams, they feel real while we're in them, right? It's only when we wake up that we realize something was actually strange. Let me ask you a question. You never really remember the beginning of a dream, do you? You always wind up right in the middle of what's going on.
In media res.
Yes, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So how did we end up here?
Well, we just came from the,
Think about it, Ariadne. How did you get here? Where are you right now?
We're dreaming?
You're actually in the middle of the workshop right now, sleeping. This is your first lesson in shared dreaming. Stay calm.
How? Once she's aware that it's not a dream, it can go ballistic. Once she's aware that it is a dream, that is what I meant.
Yeah.
How do you make a scene like this?
A lot of hard work.
It's just a dream, then why are you...
Because it's never just a dream, is it? And a face full of glass hurts like hell. When you're in it, it feels real.
Face full of glass hurts like hell. So creating that scene with everything exploding, that is largely digital. Actually,
okay.
There are a couple of things that they shot on location, and they're just, you know, blowing stuff into the street, and it's like prop foamy stuff, so it can fly around and hit things and it won't break anything.
Yeah.
They also filmed some live action elements of actual things blowing apart.
Uh-huh.
But they filmed them either against a blue screen or black, so you can like separate it out and then you can comp it in.
Real things, but we're, yeah.
Real things. And then a whole bunch of it is just CG. But because there are real elements that were filmed on location, and then other elements that are comped in, and then CG elements that are also composited into the shot, your brain can't pick which one's real and which one's not, so it just looks like the whole street is falling apart.
Yeah.
People bang on and on about how Christopher Nolan hates CGI and whatever. Christopher Nolan uses CGI all the time. This movie has 750 plus visual effect shots in it. But what Christopher Nolan does really, really well mm-hmm. is mix CGI with practical stuff so that you can't pick what's what.
Yeah.
And that's what makes visual effects work really, really well.
The interplay between the physical reality and the dream reality, when he talks about the face full of glass, it hurts and then you wake up and it doesn't hurt anymore. That also works in reverse, though. What's going on in our real world can affect what's going on in the dream. One of my most vivid memories is as a child, I woke up from a drowning nightmare.
Mm.
And the reason I had the nightmare is because my nose was clogged and my mouth was closed in my sleep. And so I stopped breathing.
So you woke up and...
And so I had the physical sensation that I wasn't breathing, and that made it into the dream.
Wow.
That I was drowning.
Yeah.
And it was terrifying. I mean, I was really shook up.
And sort of piggybacking on that, like, you know, he says that in the dream we both create and perceive our reality.
Simultaneously,
which is obviously exactly what's happening in a dream. Our brain is creating it and then we're perceiving it. But how much does that apply to, you know, disordered mental health or even, honestly, just regular life?
Yeah.
Because, you know, like the Matrix says...
What is real? How do you define real? If you're talking about what you can feel, what you can smell, what you can taste and see, then real is simply electrical signals interpreted by your brain.
And is that something that you can then use as a therapist? You can be the person that gets in between the creation and perception.
Yeah.
To change. Is that what CBT is?
Yeah, there's definitely an element of that. I mean, what I would say, and I've said before, is that your subjective perception is not objective reality.
Okay.
No matter how much it feels like it is. In dreams, it's so much more potent because you can literally, just like in the film, create cities, create streets, create environments. And I think it's fun when my brain like mixes and mashes from my life history and puts things together that were never together. And it feels very real and it's very detailed and it's enough that you trick yourself. You accept it as reality while you're in there.
Yeah.
When you're awake, it's a longer process, right? You create it in one stage and then you create it physically and so on and so forth. But psycho-emotionally, we create our realities in terms of how we interpret what's happening to us. What this means or why this is happening or what are the intentions of the person that I'm talking to or how does the world work or how do relationships work? And we accept these things as reality. And some people question those things obsessively, mm-hmm. but most of us just accept our subjective perception as this is the way it is. And so when he talks about taking hold of the creative process, we can do that in real life. And to the point of your question, we do that in therapy by saying, okay, here are the facts, but we can completely rearrange the meaning to something that serves you and supports you as opposed to something that drags you down because it's all subjective anyway, right?
Yeah.
And that's a very powerful thing.
Why don't you give us another 5 minutes?
5 minutes? What? We were talking for like at least an hour.
In a dream, your mind functions more quickly, therefore time seems to feel more slow.
5 minutes in the real world gives you an hour in the dream.
Why don't you see what you can get up to in 5 minutes?
This, when I was watching, felt 100% accurate to my experience.
Yep.
And so I was really curious what the research says on this, because I don't know if that's a real thing or not. And here's what I discovered. It's called time dilation.
Okay.
That phrase exists in different contexts. Nolan also explores more astrophysical time dilation in Interstellar, where time functions differently depending on your speed and velocity and your relation to gravity. And time dilation in dreams is more of a theoretical concept. It's not proven. In fact, there have been studies shown where people felt like they were in a dream for 20 minutes and they woke up and reported. They said, how long do you think you were asleep? And they say about 20 minutes is how long the dream felt, and they were asleep for 20 minutes. What the research suggests, but it's not proven, that the deeper you're sleeping, the more you can experience it.
Oh, okay.
In other words, if you're not in a deep sleep and you're dreaming, your dream
is more or less in real time.
It's more or less in real time. Unlike the film, though, it's not exclusively the deeper you go, the longer the dream is relative to reality.
Mm-hmm.
So the film's dream within a dream within a dream, and at each layer you have longer amounts of time.
Yeah,
there's not really any evidence of that. In fact, sometimes it keeps pace with real time. Sometimes it speeds up. Sometimes it slows down.
Well, Christopher Nolan can't have time be linear. He's allergic to it. Literally every movie he's ever made is about time. Except some of the Batman movies, but some of them are also about time.
Surprise!
Get that coat out of my face!
I guess I thought that the dream space would be all about the visual, but it's more about the feel of it. My question is, what happens when you start messing with the physics of it all?
So absolutely, in my experience, you do feel things, right? Have you felt physical sensations in dreams that weren't real?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, zero gravity is a big one. I have a lot of flying dreams.
Okay.
But the thing that I love about this is she says what they're going to do. It's not, she says, I thought it would be about how it looks, but it's about how it feels. When you're making a movie, the way you make somebody feel something is music and sound. And so you look at this, and these visuals are, you know, pretty psychedelic and crazy, a city folding over on top of itself. But what makes it work is the sound design and the music.
Yeah.
Something, isn't it?
That's what makes you feel that the world is shifting around you.
I had never considered Inception as Christopher Nolan talking about how movies are made, but it absolutely is.
It is just, it's his 2.5 hour treatise on this is what movies are and how they work.
That's wild.
Yep.
I love that shot.
It's so good.
And I also love just in the story that she says, what happens when you mess around with the physics? And then she goes ahead and messes around with the physics just because she can.
Yeah.
Why are they all looking at me?
Because my subconscious feels that someone else is creating this world. The more you change things, the quicker the projections start to converge on you.
Converge?
They sense the foreign nature of the dreamer. They attack like white blood cells fighting an infection.
Like they're going to attack us?
No. Just you.
This is another thing. People complain that Christopher Nolan does not have a sense of humor. He has a dry sense of humor.
Yeah.
And it is all over the place, and it is fantastic.
Okay, so question. This movie is 2.5 hours long.
Yep.
The first hour is exposition. It's exposition.
Wall to wall. Yeah.
It's exposition while stuff is happening. But to actually understand what's happening in the rest of the movie, there's so much setup, and he does it in a way that's not boring. And also doesn't feel like exposition for the audience. How Correct. Do you do something like that?
So we have a really, really strong audience surrogate character, Ariadne, played brilliantly by Elliot Page. He's doing amazing work here, just really being curious and thoughtful, but also intelligent. Like mm-hmm. Ariadne moves so fast that the audience can't get ahead of her.
Yeah.
Which is great because a lot of times what makes exposition boring is like, I already understand this.
Yeah.
And she's never behind us.
So when two characters are saying something to each other that they both already know, that's bad exposition.
That is bad exposition. Ariadne is learning, while we go along with her, all of the rules of how this works.
Yeah.
And she's so smart that as soon as he says one thing, she extrapolates, you know, a whole bunch of stuff and folds a city in half.
Yeah. So and she moves like, the exposition along.
She moves the exposition along. It's really, really, really strong writing. And yeah. There is a ton of exposition that you got to get through because Nolan creates an entire world of here's the real world, here's the dream world, here's how the interactions between those work, here's how the rules work in this world, oh, and then there's multiple levels of this world, here's how all of those work. Like
it's so much yeah.
that it shouldn't work.
You shouldn't be able to follow it as an audience member. It's like, no. This is too much. This is too much of an ask.
Christopher Nolan made you feel like a genius. He made you feel like it was hard to follow and you couldn't keep up, but you understood everything. That is such an amazing magic trick.
A note about the projections thing. I mean, there's absolutely dream versions of people, which we'll, which we'll address more in a second. But the idea that there's a foreign person in my brain and the projections are going to converge on them, that's just for the film because we have no baseline in reality for that.
No.
Although there are attempts now to get us to a place of shared dreaming. I was reading about this, mm-hmm. which is wild. How crazy would that be?
Terrifying. I don't want anybody inside my subconscious.
This is great, but I'm telling you, if you keep changing things like this.
So what Nolan does with CG in his movies so well is it doesn't feel like CG.
No, it feels like they built a big thing that does that, but they didn't.
Which is also why this movie works for me better than like What Dreams May Come, as cool as that is visually, is my dreams don't feel like a CGI dream fest. They feel like a lived-in.
It feels real.
It feels real and just crazy stuff is happening. And that is all throughout Inception. It feels like you're on location watching this happen.
Well, and this is a crazy, crazy CGI shot. That one and this one. Because there's an entire camera crew and lighting department.
And they're not
all
there.
All kinds of stuff.
They should be right there.
In that shot.
Yeah.
They're in the shot, and then they got removed.
Wow.
Huge amount of work. Really, really great work from Double Negative in London.
Biggest support of Leo DiCaprio is Chris Nolan, as he dresses and does his hair exactly like Chris Nolan.
Exactly like Chris Nolan.
Yeah.
Very
Very impressive.
The love story in this movie gets me so hard.
It gets me so hard. So hard.
I would phrase that differently.
I know this room.
It gets me this in the feels so hard. Oh my gosh.
The college.
Never. Oh, that's staying in. It makes me feel things emotionally. That's what I meant. It hits me hard.
A street lamp or a phone booth never
entire area. Oh my gosh, why?
What? Building a dream from your memory is the easiest way to lose your grasp.
The one who said it.
Is that what happened to you?
Listen, this has nothing to do with me, you understand?
Is that why you need me to build your dreams?
Get off of
projections are creepy as hell in this.
Yeah, I love how they're just sort of stone-faced. And it's just random everybody.
Wake me up!
Except for Mom.
Wake me up! Wake me up!
Hey, look at me. You're okay. Hey.
Why wouldn't I wake up?
Because there was still some time on the clock. You can't wake up from within the dream unless you die.
She'll need a totem.
What?
A totem. It's a small
That's
personal...
That's some subconscious you've got on you, Cobb. She's a real charmer.
Oh, I see you met Mrs. Cobb.
She's his wife?
Again, very dry, and Joseph Gordon-Levitt understood the assignment.
So two quick things that I love about this that are very true to life. One is that there are projections of real people in our dreams that do not have to act at all like the real people. My wife has had dreams where I was an absolute unfaithful, abusive monster.
It gets me so hard.
And then she wakes up and I'm like, are you okay? She says, yeah, no, you're fine. The other thing I like is that from the time she wakes up to the end of the scene, there might be a full minute there, she's still physiologically elevated, because here's the thing. I cannot stand it in movies when people wake up from something horrifying and immediately go, oh, it was just a dream.
Oh boy, no. Your brain dumped a ton of adrenaline into your body.
Yes.
It's in there. You're amped up.
Dreams affect us physiologically and psychologically even after they end. They just continue. And that's the thing about dreaming is we don't really control the dream.
Just like Cobb can't control Maul, right?
Yeah, you can't control Maul. You can't control your subconscious. You're largely along for the ride.
I will split up my father's empire. Now, this is obviously an idea that Robert himself would choose to reject, which is why we need to plant it deep in his subconscious. The subconscious is motivated by emotion, right? Not reason. We need to find a way to translate this into an emotional concept.
How do you translate a business strategy into an emotion?
And that's what we're here to figure out, right? Now, Robert's relationship with his father is stressed, to say the least.
What can we run with that? We could suggest to him breaking up his father's company as a screw you to the old man.
No, because I think positive emotion trumps negative emotion every time. We all yearn
Bingo.
For reconciliation, for catharsis. We need Robert Fisher to have a positive emotional reaction to all this.
Christopher Nolan talking about movies.
My father accepts that I want to create for myself, not follow in his footsteps.
That might work.
Might? We're gonna need to do a little better than might.
Oh, thank you for your contribution, Arthur.
Studio note. And response to studio note.
Holy crap.
It's just making movies, people!
I never saw that, but now I can't unsee
it. You can't unsee it. It's gonna completely reframe everything you think about this movie.
That's wild.
Yeah.
Okay, but positive emotion trumps negative emotion every time. I wanted to include this scene because that is the way I approach therapy. And that's how people actually heal instead of staying in therapy the rest of their lives.
Yeah.
And look, don't get me wrong, chronic mental illness, you may need lifelong support. I'm not talking about that.
Yeah.
I'm talking about problems that have solutions and building towards them so you can have that cathartic release, have the insight, and move forward.
Yep.
You need that positive emotional experience. He says we all crave reconciliation.
And catharsis.
And I think that's super powerful.
And that's what we're all doing here. We crave reconciliation and catharsis through the medium of film. Also, Cobb does not realize it, but he is laying out his journey.
Yeah.
As a business proposition, basically. Like, here's how we pull off the heist. We give me exactly what I need.
Well, because you think about it, Robert Fisher, which is the Cillian Murphy character, they're talking about how to put this idea in his mind And it's all about his release. It's all about his healing so that they can achieve their objective, right? Mm-hmm. And the reason why a lot of people think that Cobb was dreaming is because he gets his release.
He gets the exact same thing that Cillian Murphy does, because the whole thing's been about Cobb the whole time.
Yeah.
Because everyone's all up in their own heads.
Yeah.
Which is really good writing.
Clever girl.
So they're going to create a dream where Robert Fisher is going to experience reconciliation and catharsis with his father.
Yeah.
Can you experience real life catharsis through a dream? And can that actually be healing?
I'm going to speak to this one not from the research or my studies or my professional experience, just my own personal experience.
Anecdotes are great. Love them.
Absolutely. I've had several dreams with my mother that helped me through my grief, where I could say things to her that I didn't get to say to her in real life. Mm-hmm. Just having the emotional release of it means that I can move on. And even when I woke up, instead of like, oh, it didn't happen in real life, I'm like, it still feels good. I still had the physiological and emotional experience that I carried with me. So yes, I think dreams can be cathartic and healing.
Awesome.
I do think sometimes we have dreams and nightmares about things we're unwilling to face in real life.
I have a lot of those.
Or we're not ready to face in real life. And the brain says, yeah, I've been trying to get your attention with this and you've been ignoring me. So now we're going to do this when you can't control it, because mm-hmm. it needs to be dealt with.
Yeah.
When people ask, why do I have this recurring nightmare? I always ask, okay, well, what are you not dealing with?
Why haven't you dealt with it in real life?
That theory has proven true, at least for me, in therapy with people, because generally when they deal with it in real life, the nightmares stop.
Yeah, that would be hard to prove empirically, but
yeah,
anecdotally, that sounds accurate.
So this brings us to the question, does the top fall?
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
Why?
Because I need reconciliation and catharsis.
Exactly. I think the top falls because it wobbles. And normally when they spin it in the movie, it wobbles as it's getting going. And then it hits this spot and it doesn't. It just, that's my logical reason. But the real reason why I think the top falls is because I need it to.
Mm-hmm.
Because I want Cobb to be with his kids.
Yeah. But then, of course, cutting away before it falls equaled at least $50 million of repeat viewing box office.
Yeah.
So genius move.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to figure out a way that I can cut away from the top before it falls in my next movie.
All right, rock on.
So until next time.
I bought the airline. It seemed neater.
You're waiting for a train. A train that'll take you far away. And
we harmonized. That was nice.
That was great. We're very talented. If you want to watch a longer version of this, there are director's cuts of all of our episodes on our Patreon, and you can be like
Serafina Pikala,
Loki the Demigod Got the TARDIS,
Sage O'Reilly,
Destry Griffiths,
Cheesecake, Cheesecakey?
I think it's Cheesecake. Anyway, okay. They're patrons of ours, and you can be like them and watch stuff.
And yeah, get bonus stuff and all sorts of cool things.
It can get you hard. In the feels.
So hard.